All right. Takes a while. First of all,
okay, wait one second.
Okay.
I just want to start off with saying thank you, Lisa, for making this happen. It's a wonderful opportunity to talk and to share with people about my experiences with Alan Steinfeld and how he got me into public access television and eventually how we traveled around the country and the world to explore new realities. When I first heard the term new realities, I thought, that's a dumb term. How can you have a new reality? Reality is just one. There's only one reality. But I've since learned to understand the wisdom in that, in those terms. So, thank you.
Nice. Thank you. Thanks so much for meeting with me. Didn't even know me and trusting what I'm trying to do. And I'm just trying to adjust my iris.
Okay. I guess I'd like to know, what's your biggest interest in new realities? Or what does new realities mean to you? And then maybe I can help you better. Because this is such a huge field.
It is.
Talking about, I think I was with Alan for 7, 9 years, you know, a long time.
Yeah.
We even got married in India.
I heard. I want to know about that. I do. There are lots of levels to it that are interesting to me. I've always been drawn to the idea that there are things we don't know, things that our current science does not fully acknowledge, at least the mainstream paradigm that we have. I've always been kind of...
Well, when you say things that we don't know, in other words, you sense that there's more to know, that you want to unlock and know, that's either consciously or unconsciously been denied you?
Yes. Or that I've been drawn to some of these ideas that consciousness goes beyond the physical...
Consciousness goes beyond the physical is an important place to start, and I guess most people talk about meditation to get you beyond the physical, but there's also something about the physical that's very interesting. In other words, where isn't consciousness? If you can't say where it isn't, then that means it's everywhere, including in the physical. So then you have to respect all of the physical sciences. So if there is a supernatural science, it should include the natural. And ultimately, Alan and I did study with the master in the south of India, who said that supernatural science, or the miracles, also follow with science, so they're not really unscientific, but it's just how much reality do you want to take in. And I remember when I was active in the transcendental meditation movement, which was, you know, the level of knowledge I had was, I don't know if you'd say sanitized, or to make it marketable for thousands and thousands of people, it had to be restricted. For example, when I first learned transcendental meditation, one of the first requirements was that 15 days before you got initiated, you shouldn't be taking any recreational drugs, no marijuana, no LSD. And I was a college student then, and I was actually practicing yoga after somebody gave me some hashish. And I discovered I could go explore these amazing spaces in my mind. I would like to smoke it by myself and read esoteric books. And then when I practiced yoga, I was actually aiming towards not sleeping. because I felt I could get so deeply relaxed by the postures, and I could have such profound insights into things. I remember for one philosophy class, I wrote a paper, and I'd have to think about what the paper was, but I do remember it was really coming from my heart deeply. But when the professor read it in front of the class, and as soon as he was going to read it, I said, well, of course he's going to read it. It was a really great paper. But the thing was, people started laughing. It was interpreted as humor. And I later on saw how it was interpreted as humor, but it wasn't meant to be humorous. It was coming from a very, very deep place inside me. So when I was at home, I was a college student at the University of California at Santa Cruz. We were passing a joint around, and there was one guy who didn't take the joint. He passed it on. And I thought, well, you know, that's kind of inhospitable. You know, why is he doing that? And then he said he had learned something called transcendental meditation, and that in order to do it, you couldn't smoke marijuana, or maybe he said it affected his meditation, you know, whatever it was. And I said, well, that's interesting. Tell your teacher to call me, to talk to me. And so eventually his teacher called me, and eventually it came out after I got the lecture on how to be prepared to get your mantra and so on, is that 15 days before you start, you shouldn't take any drugs. And I was smoking hashish then, and I really thought I was in top shape because I had had allergies all my life, so much so that there was a top allergist in Santa Cruz, California, and he was in an iron lung himself. And so when you'd go see this doctor, he'd look at you through a mirror, and he was really good. Well, he eventually gave me syringes, so in case I had an attack with, I think they were taking a little bit of house dust, you know, to try to build up your immunity so you're not allergic. And I was mostly allergic to cats. I was wildly allergic to cats. But they say if they try to build up the immunity to cats, that the patient might have a super reaction, so they don't deal with cats. So they were dealing with house dust. But there was always this fear that as you build up your immunity, you might have an attack. So I had a syringe in the case that I needed to give myself some, whatever it is, I can't even remember now. And so I remember when I started smoking hashish, no allergies whatsoever. And also I remember just being so happy and high, and I could run around without shoes, even in the rain, and it didn't bother me. And I was getting an enormous amount done with my studies, so I thought, this is great. And then I started to read esoteric books, and then I got a book on yoga. I started doing yoga, and that was really amazing because at 14 years old, figure at this point, my first, no, it's probably my, I can't remember. I was in college. I started at 17 years old. 17, 18, 19. So by the time I'm 20, I'm graduating. So somewhere in there, I learned how to meditate. I was only involved with smoking hashish for about a month out of that time. But anything I do really passionately. So I wanted to learn transcendental meditation so I could get higher and do yoga longer and sleep less, because I was convinced that was a waste of time. And my teacher was adamant, no, I had to stop for 15 days. Well, he was only initiating twice a month or once a month or whatever. And so in order to get on the next initiation round, I would only have 13 days. So I remember being guilty for years thinking, well, maybe I'm not enlightened yet because I didn't wait 15 days. But the thing was, is I learned how to meditate. I stopped, and I really was shocked, because after 3 days, I did see that I was more dependent on the hashish than I had realized. So that was kind of an eye-opener to me. And then I, very shortly after learning how to meditate, being initiated was a incredible experience. It's only a ceremony that's about 5 minutes. It's a very standard puja, which means an offering to the tradition that the teacher who's handing on the mantra is, he's acknowledging his tradition. So in my case, it was Brahmanandi Saraswati, Jagad Guru from the north. There were like four main in Hinduism in India. They have four seats in the Shankaracharya tradition, and he had the most important seat. This was a man who'd spent 40 years of his life in the woods, in the forests, and they enticed him to come out. And when he came out, World War II was happening, so he was doing a lot of pujas, you know, big ceremonies to offset the problems of the war. So eventually, Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, who interestingly enough was a student activist in his day, and he was all about probably more land for the peasants and so on, and he became completely enchanted with his guru, you know, Brahmananda Saraswati, the recluse who was eventually enticed out into the world to take on these responsibilities. He brought it to the West, and the first people who were interested were old ladies. They were theosophists. And then the psychedelic movement came along, and so Maharishi Mahesh Yogi all of a sudden had throngs of people who were interested in developing higher states of consciousness. Well, probably initially he just gave them their mantra and didn't care about whether they took LSD or marijuana. And even from his tradition, marijuana is part of it, so he probably wouldn't have been grumbling for that reason. But he could pretty much see that if he wanted to get a movement going, these hippies were not really in good graces with the powers that be that he needed to get in good graces with in order to advance what he was trying to do, which I feel now was to remove the from the neck of the world this corporate structure, this monopoly, because the suffering that went on in India because of the white man was enormous. And this is something that took me 4 years of being in India before people were kind of really, you know, hipping me to. They hide this. And even Mahatma Gandhi, keep in mind, he was assassinated by one of the people close to him. So when everyone goes on and on about Mahatma Gandhi, I firsthand had, and it was hard, one firsthand, got a whole different insight on that. So when I got initiated, I was having spectacular experiences. I was leaving my body. I was watching myself sleep. So, of course, I was going to follow any kind of rule or regulation that this organization gave. So here was hashish that had been such a spiritual opening for me, being told that it was off the program. And I remember talking to one transcendental meditator, and I said, well, what happens when you smoke marijuana? And he goes, well, I couldn't meditate properly for 2 weeks. And I go, 2 weeks? Holy Toledo, I intend to be in cosmic consciousness by 2 weeks. I can't take 2 weeks out of my time. So I just, never did any drugs at all. But decades went by, at least 20 years, or even 25 or so, and I eventually encountered Swami Kaleshwar. And I don't know, should I skip up to this? Because at my meeting, Alan comes in between.
Okay.
But I don't want to miss the Rampa School of Enlightenment either.
I know that's about that. That's an important one, okay. Yeah. Okay, so, yeah, tell me how you, well, you became interested in India and Indian philosophy at a young age then.
Well, college, is that a young age?
Yeah.
No, college, okay.
Uh-huh. And, okay.
At 14 years old, I had scoliosis. And at that time, Kaiser Permanente, I think, was working with insurance, medical insurance. And so I had access to a very expensive operation, which was grafting 10 vertebrae with calf bone and putting 2 metal rods in my back and being in a body cast for half a year. Well, they showed me all these pictures of spines that were like an S, and so I wanted to do the operation. But I now realize it was a grisly operation. I was a victim of medical experiments, there's no question in my mind. And eventually at 21, when I learned transcendental meditation and went on a long course, The rods in my back were so uncomfortable that I went and confronted my orthopedic surgeon, Dr. Blackman, and told him that my spine was changing and I couldn't stand the rods in my back. And he told me, it's impossible, your spine can't change, you're 21 years old, you're not 14 anymore. And I said, my spine is changing because I'm meditating. And he said, well, then stop meditating. And I said, I can't stop meditating. I was just enjoying these sublime levels of consciousness. So that happened to me when, you know, all in my college years, when I have these bad allergies and so on, I have this metal in my back. The metal was in my back for about 7 years. I just want to put that in because that will really figure into a lot of what ensues later on, particularly my battle with the medical establishment.
And so you had it taken out?
I had it taken out at 21. After I learned transcendental meditation teacher training, and who was my teacher training course leader was John Gray. He eventually went on to be the man that had men are from Mars, women are from Venus.
So he's a doctor.
Yeah, he was some kind of psychotherapist. I'm sure he wasn't trained as a psychoanalyst. That took me years to learn about the study of psychoanalysis and Sigmund Freud. I was just enjoying the experience. I had bad allergies. Hashish got rid of the allergies. And then later on, when I went on the long teacher training course, my spine, you know, the metal was in the way. So I'm one of the very rare people that had Harrington rods put in their back and then taken out again. But later on, I hope we'll talk about yoga and India and there'll be more drama about my back.
Okay, I will make a mental note there.
Yeah, right. By the time I met Alan, I do remember he did not have a high regard for transcendental meditation.
Oh, interesting.
So there's different cycles and phases. When Maharishi came through, he initiated a lot of people that I would say he got the first rush after the psychedelic movement. So the hippies were cutting their hair, they were putting neckties on and, you know, going out to meet the world. And they were so enchanted with this experience, anything was worth it. Because when you initiate somebody, you also go into this sublime heavenly level.
So and you were always, what kind of family were you brought up in?
That's an interesting question. My mother met my father in Athens, Greece, when she came over with the Marshall Plan, which was a plan to restore the economy of Europe after World War II and to help countries not fall under the evil hand of communism. But in truth, the communists were worse than the Nazis. I got that firsthand from people who lived through all of that. And now I'm learning it's all about grabbing the resources, whatever you call yourself, you know, a communist or a Nazi or a New Deal person in the case of America, because really what America did with the bankruptcy in 1933 is really outrageous. So I believe that eventually Maharishi Mahesh Yogi himself was hoping through creating higher states of consciousness and having people become more mature so that you can shed the rules and the regulations and smoke some pot now and then, just like, you know, in their tradition, you know, it's part of Ayurvedic medicine. But at that time, there were very rigid rules and regulations. You had to have short hair. Women had to have nylon stockings, shave your legs, you know. He didn't want any kind of trace of hippiness around. So, you know, that set my mind at an early age kind of against the whole hippie style. You see what I mean? Because I had this spectacular experience and I was going to follow anything I was told. It took me many, many years until I was sitting on the banks of the Ganges around 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, meditating and realizing it was in Varanasi that the transcendental meditation energy came from. But that gets into Tantra and that's a lot farther. I was told later by Brahmins who were seducing me or trying to get me away from my interest in Sri Sai Kaleshwara Swami, who wanted people to know he didn't even use the word tantra. He said that's too dangerous a word. It will be too misunderstood. He called it Paramashiva Yoga. Now, if you analyze Paramashiva Yoga, para means beyond. Shiva means silence or consciousness. So you always think from the transcendental meditation point of view, you take the active mind and you make it quieter and quieter to become very sublime and very holy, and that activity and all of that isn't what you want. But Paramashiva Yoga means going beyond the silence. So if you go beyond the silence, now you're back into activity. So you see, it's a cycle.
Wow.
Yeah. And then from a tantric point of view, having traveled 4 years in India, going to the different temples and places, it was when I was on the banks of the Ganges that I felt that same energy that I was able to get on initiation through transcendental meditation. But Maharishi Mahesh Yogi himself was highly criticized for having given Westerners, outcasts, this initiation that should only go to a certain caste in India. And Varanasi is where Hindus send their young boys at puberty, just like a bar mitzvah in Judaism. Or instead of going to Jerusalem, in India, the equivalent is Varanasi. Or there's another name for it. It's a very, very old city in India. And Mark Twain said, Varanasi is older than time. Varanasi is older than history. And if you look at Varanasi, it's older than all of this put together. And the last I heard, the Japanese were buying up the ghats, where the temples would have steps down to the Ganges River. So again, you're back to real estate. The physical land has energy. That's the point. And traditions perhaps can take some of that teaching to other places and share. But Maharishi was criticized for violating something sacred by giving it to outcasts, and on top of that, giving it to women. And then on top of that, making women teachers, making these Westerners teachers. So of course he wanted to be really careful. And the hippie movement was something that was too sudden, too fleeting, and it was too risky. I can now understand why he did what he did. But it certainly prejudiced me against it, because I grew up in Berkeley, California, and you would see the psychedelic posters around, and now I know from my husband, Joe Barton, who was very much involved with the whole commune scene, I missed a lot of good concerts, and you could see the beautiful psychedelic posters. It was a wonderful time.
But you stayed away from the hippie movement.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I was just, I wanted God. I wanted the highest possible, and I was eliminating all distractions. I was celibate through my entire 20s. But part of that reason was, as while I was married at 19 for a year and a half. And right after I got divorced is when I learned transcendental meditation. But in that time, I had gotten pregnant on an IUD, and a very terrible experience was I thought I had some deathly illness. And when I went up to the student health place, they wanted me to take a pregnancy test. I was just like insulted. I said, I've got something horrible and we're losing valuable time. I had morning sickness. So I was 2 weeks pregnant when I had the abortion. But after I had the abortion, I felt terrible about it. I felt horrible. And I remember going to my ethics professor and I saying, do you realize that ethics is based physiologically? I said, a week ago, I wouldn't have cared about getting an abortion. There was no religious thing that I was growing up around. So getting back to my religious background, my mother married my father, who was Greek Orthodox, And my mother was Catholic. They married in Greece, and they married in both churches. They married in the Catholic Church and the Greek Orthodox Church. But in order to get married, the children had to be promised to be brought up Catholic and to be brought up Greek Orthodox. So the big problem was, how are you going to bring up the kids? So my grandmother, I'm born December 22nd, 1951. So my grandparents, my mother's parents, because now my father's from Greece, my mother's German, second or third generation, and they were bakers in Red Bluff, California, and my grandmother from the old country came over, and she felt my grandfather was a good catch, but she didn't really love him. You didn't really marry for love in those days. And I believe my grandfather was really in love with the Protestant, but Catholics didn't marry Protestants. I mean, this is unthinkable today, but that's how it was then. So I was stolen and baptized Catholic in March of 1952. There's a baptismal certificate, and my baptismal certificate says Paula Maria Tsakonas, because they didn't know my middle name. But my legal name on the baptism, on my birth certificate, is Paula Gloria Tsakonas. So when my father found out that I had been baptized, he was furious. And at that point, when I would go spend time with my grandparents, I would go to church with them. But as I grew up, I could never take communion because I most certainly wasn't going to be confirmed. You know, I just squeaked through being baptized. But none of my siblings who followed me, you know, nobody ever wanted to ever even go there, what to do about this. And eventually, I did get confirmed. That was years later, after I learned the levitation technique with Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, but that's another story.
So you knew Maharishi Mahesh Yogi?
I didn't know him personally. Okay. Some other teachers had more access to him. I met him a little bit now and then when I became a teacher. Maybe he gave me the mantras. I hardly remember. And then I met him in 1980 in New Delhi, India, when Deepak Chopra was coming on the scene. And by the time I saw him, this is really strange, I said, you know, I don't really like this guy. But prior to that, for at least a decade, because this was all through my 20s, I was like riveted on him. So that later on will be my, if we go into it farther with the other masters that we encountered, particularly through Alan, was always my fear. I never wanted to be under the under such an influence again, because I just felt when I actually finally met him and saw him that I didn't like him. This seems really strange, doesn't it? So by the time I met Sri Sai Kaleshwar Swami and we went to the south of India, he had to beg me to come back to India, because when I met him with Alan, I wasn't with Alan the very first time I met him, but eventually when I was working with him, with Alan, he said, you have to learn about the Divine Mother. You have to learn about the five elements if you really wanted to do all these good things, because I'd made $5 million by then, and I wanted to create a charity and do good things. I taught transcendental meditation in San Quentin Prison, and I had a friend who had a PhD. She went to Reed College, and you know, she had a PhD in the hard sciences, so it wasn't a wimpy PhD. This was a really smart woman. She did a recidivism study on transcendental meditation, and which would have been that study itself would have been the equivalent of a master's degree. It was meticulously done, and it proved that meditators in prison don't come back to prison as much, showing conclusively millions of dollars that the state could save. So I couldn't understand why I couldn't be paid. At least I wanted $40 an hour. That seemed like a lot of money, but I'm comparing it to saving millions of dollars for the state of California. And I had to cover my retail furniture store then at $5 an hour. And since I was a better salesman than anybody I could hire, and I'm always sweating bullets about covering the rent for my retail store, this was putting a strain on me, and I thought, hey, you know, the state of California could cough up a little money. I'm doing wonderful things with these prisoners and with the warden and his wife. So when that was rejected, I said, if I don't stand up for what I'm worth, that's sicker than me trying to give these men self-esteem through meditation. And it was really with a heavy heart that I walked away from teaching in one of the worst prisons in the country. But it wasn't worse for me. It was wonderful. It was heavenly. The men treated me so respectfully. They loved their meditation. It was a great experience. But I wasn't being paid, and I said, I just can't afford to do this. So I stopped doing it. But I realized then and there, there's another agenda going on, and it has to do with money. And I felt like Helen Keller. You know, she couldn't see and she couldn't hear, and they had to learn how to trace into her palm to communicate. And I said, here are these recidivism studies. Here's these prisoners. Here's this amazing program that can help them. Why isn't it happening? So I said, I don't understand this society. I need to learn the language, and the language must be money. I must need to go out and get money. So I went out. It took a couple of years, and I made $5 million in cellular telephone licenses. And that still didn't work. So I'm on the tail end of my fortune. And then Swami Kaleshwar comes along, and he says, you need to learn about the Divine Mother and the five elements. And I had no idea what he was talking about. He said, give India another chance. You know, I said, I've done the Hindu thing. I've done the mantras, I'm not... Because also Alan got me into the romp, the School of Enlightenment. Because in India, 1980, Dr. Keith Wallace was talking to Maharishi in front of about 3,000 people. And we were in Goenka's Indian Express building. And Goenka was a big newspaper man. And at that time, Goenka was under attack from Indira Gandhi, who was really pissed at him, because Indira Gandhi had been in prison. And while she was in prison, or maybe helping her to get into prison, Goenka published against her. So now she was very wrathful against Goenka, and she was going to chop down his building. He had an 11-story building, and they were going to make retroactive the zoning code and cut down his building. So what he did was he opened his whole building up to Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, who then is giving an international conference on immortality and the cities. And he's inviting people who are not just doing transcendental meditation and getting quieter and quieter, but from Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, starting now to say little phrases that start to develop supernormal powers, including levitation. We used to practice it on foam rubber. And so he filled his building for publicity's sake. Years later, I went back to New Delhi, and they chopped the building down, so it didn't really work. But that's when I first saw Deepak Chopra. And Deepak Chopra said, I don't want to get involved with you because all the teachers of meditation are so poor. And Maharishi said he didn't have to be poor, but eventually I think they separated over money. But so I thought I'd learn the language of money. I made money. I learned that. But at the tail end of that course, Dr. Keith Wallace was speaking in front of 3,000 people. Now, at this time, the conference had gone on for about 3 months, and people wanted to go shopping and go see the Taj Mahal and do other things and listen to lectures in this very stuffy place. And particularly people who were close to Maharishi, I can't remember what their special term was, they had seats in the front aisles. And whenever a scientist was making a presentation, a lot of people thought it was boring. They'd rather listen to Maharishi talk about the Vedas, and you close your eyes and you swim in the energy. But I loved science, and I particularly liked biology. I had a wonderful biology teacher in high school. I went to a private girls' school, and my teacher was studying under Gunter Stent at the University of California at Berkeley, all about DNA, and she dropped out in order to put her husband, who was getting a PhD, through school, And she didn't have to go through, in a public school, you have to get extra credentials. But in a private school, you can just show that you know the material and you can teach. So I was reading The Molecular Biology of the Gene by Watson when I was in high school. So when Dr. Keith Wallace, who was studying the physiology of the meditator, when he starts talking, like, I'm really interested in this topic. So everybody is leaving the lecture hall because it's a boring science discussion. And what I start doing is ratcheting my way from the back up front, because around masters, for whatever reason, there is a field of power. And when you're in that field, it's really groovy and wonderful. So the lectures were considered so boring that even the guards that were supposed to protect these front rows for those people who were in Maharishi's entourage, you know, they spent years with him in Switzerland. These seats were empty, but even the guards weren't there. So I snuck up, and I remember in the lecture, the first maybe 45 minutes, I swear, Maharishi kept looking at me, and I'm thinking, oh shoot, I don't belong here, I shouldn't be here. He knows it, you know, but like I'm so loving the material. And pretty soon, you know, Maharishi's looking around, where are the guards, why is, you know, because he can feel my energy. I must be a drain on him, because the people close to him are women in very expensive saris and jewelry, and that wasn't me, you know. I mean, I was in a sari, but it wasn't expensive, and I didn't have jewelry. And so I'm sitting there listening, and Keith Wallace is starting to talk about all of the new science that indicates we can live much longer and much healthier than we're living. And so he loved Maharishi. His heart was open to Maharishi. He was really into meditation. And Maharishi really loved him and was really happy that he had a first-class scientist on board, because Keith Wallace had his studies published in real bona fide medical journals showing that transcendental meditation was not waking, it was not sleeping, and it was not dreaming. It was a fourth major state of consciousness. So when he would start to talk about what science was discovering, Maharishi would pull in from the Vedas what the Vedas and scripture was saying about longevity and higher states of consciousness. So when Maharishi would stretch too far, Keith Wallace would say, no, the science doesn't show that. But the back and forth was an amazing play. So as I was listening to this, my heart was fulfilled, because I hadn't had a personal encounter with Maharishi when I realized I didn't really like him as a person. It was the energy that I was interested in. So my heart was so fulfilled. I was swimming in the energy, and my mind was so engaged. I was loving the stuff that Keith Wallace was saying, because he wouldn't let Maharishi swing too far into anything that couldn't be substantiated by science. So my mind was satisfied, my heart was satisfied, and pretty soon I had this experience. You know, it's like you start unstressing. And what was unstressing was seeing my husband in bed with another woman. And as this memory is coming up, I'm realizing I'm going into this really higher state of consciousness, where I absolutely understood the immortality of the cell, because they were talking about it on a cellular level, and realizing that what these saints were talking about, when you hear about masters that live for hundreds of years, I was beginning to see how it could be laid out. But then when the stress comes up, you know, and having this memory, because it's a deep memory when you're shocked like that, there's your lover in bed with someone else, and he wasn't my husband at that time. I actually married him, because I said, why did you do this when, you know, we broke up? And then he said, please, please come back. And I said, okay, I'll come back, but, you know, I got to get all my shit together here and then bring it over tomorrow. And then after he left, he goes, you know, I really miss him. I'm going to see him now. So I went over to see him now, and there he was in bed with someone else. I said, I just told you I was going to come back. Why? And then he goes, let's get married. And I go, well, you know, I said, well, why were you with her? And he goes, well, I'll tell you if we get married. And I think it's because he didn't really know, but he really felt we ought to be married. And I said, well, okay, I'll marry you if you tell me why. And he said, okay. So it was kind of like a deal we had. And I remember ranting and raving when we were having obvious marital problems at the student psychiatrist's place, to say, well, he never told me why, you know, he was, you know, and the psychotherapist or whatever is kind of like, kid, let it go. But I really did want to know, because we really did love each other. Why would a man do that, you know? And just to show you how sincere I am and how inquisitive I am and how knowledge means a lot to me, I really wanted to know. I said, I probably still do. You know, how does the human psyche work? But fast track up to me being about 27 or 28, here I am with Dr. Keith Wallace talking about higher states of consciousness and immortality. And I want to, I realize that if I don't let go of this stress, that even if Steve was absolutely wrong for being in bed with another woman, why should I sacrifice my immortality for this incident? And I thought, this is something I should never forget. This is very valuable wisdom. So I remember being in Gramercy Park and making the bed and telling Alan that I believed in immortality. Somehow immortality came up. And Alan did not flinch. And I thought, you believe that's possible? And he goes, yes. And I go, well, like, why? And then he introduced me to Ramtha. And I think I remember having some little cassettes from about Ramtha, you know, because then channeling, after I became a little more liberated from the transcendental meditation, Nazi regime, I started to explore and I found some tapes on channeling. And I do remember Ramtha talking about soulmates, encountering your soulmate, and what a great, great experience that is. And I remember saying that when soulmates meet, they can do wonderful things in the world. And of course, being a young girl, I just, you know, I want it for great sex and, you know, romance and things like that. I'm not really thinking about great contributions in the world. I want to meet my soulmate. So Alan, I found out that he knew a lot about Ramtha and about the whole soulmate thing. So because I have money then, I made $5 million in cellular telephone. We go out to Yelm, Washington, and we start taking some of those conferences. And then I learned more, and it was very profound what I learned. Also, Ramtha was the first one that shattered my notions of what it meant to be a spiritual person. Because at that time, they were doing wine ceremonies. Here I thought wine was a bad thing, alcohol. You know, I was so pristine, pure after the shock of having an abortion, even though I had an IUD that was supposed to be 99.whatever% effective. You know, now I'm convinced Big Pharma is, you know, never telling the truth. The little sperms probably use the IUD to ratchet their way up. So I did not want to get pregnant again. I was celibate for 10 years. I was waiting for my soulmate. Eventually, in my 30s, Bruce Mills, who had been one of Maharishi's secretaries and had been married himself and certainly didn't want to get pregnant, he had been sent to India with his wife to teach TM, because Indians would rather learn meditation from a white person than probably Maharishi himself. So Bruce convinced me to use condoms. Bruce, by the way, was an excellent astrologer, and he was the astrologer for Jim Sinclair, who's now known as the Gold Bug. He was analyzing the markets, and the idea was that when the planets were in a position that was very expansive and people were confident and optimistic, the price would go down of gold. But when people were contracted and worried and wanting to hold on to things, then the price of gold would go up. And this was done before computers, so Bruce had these very meticulous charts, you know, just, you know, reams and reams of all this hand-done stuff. And then, but I remember whenever he was in the markets, he was such a nervous, scholarly guy, he'd be so panicked, you know, do you think gold is going to go up or down? You know, and he'd look at me and I said, well, don't ask me, why don't we ask the garbage man? So it shows that, you know, the markets are very emotional. Even if you're really studying things and you think of knowing, you know what's going on. So Alan believed in immortality, and I thought, that is really interesting. And he did not disappoint me. When I went to the Ramtha School of Enlightenment, at that time he was using wine ceremonies where you would drink wine to drop the veil of social conditioning, and then you'd smoke pipe tobacco. You wouldn't inhale it, but if the tobacco hit the roof of your mouth, it would keep you awake so that the wine wouldn't make you fall asleep. And then you could start to embrace new realities or concepts that your social conditioning wouldn't allow you to do. And I had great experiences, really fantastic experiences at the Ramtha School of Enlightenment, including meeting Michal Ledwith, who has a very different interpretation. He's a Catholic priest, an ex-Catholic priest. And he tells a whole different story of Jesus than you normally hear. And he was also the head of a seminary in Ireland and a consultant to the Pope. So he wasn't just any Catholic priest. But eventually he got cancer, and I believe it was Ramtha's teaching that took his consciousness to a level way beyond the body, to where this extremely advanced, it was serious cancer that he had. Boom, he was healed. So that's the story of Yelm Washington.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. There's so much.
I know. You don't know.
Yeah.
No, Alan Steinfeld was really a great man. He started what is known today on the internet just by grabbing emails. He would always know. He was kind of the go-to man when a new spiritual master came to town. He was trusted in the East Village that way. And so when people got emails from Alan, they really respected, you know, what he was saying. And he was sharing from his heart. It was something that he really loved to share that. And I remember when I would sit with him and there'd be some master in town and people would want Alan to promote it, he would sort of go through their credentials. I thought it was so funny because, you know, you would think that booking a guru somehow would be different than you know, booking an act. But now I've learned it really isn't. In many ways, so much of the spiritual teaching is just another act. So when Swami Kaleshwar came into our lives, Alan had already been with Pilot Baba, who is a saint I have enormous regard for. And he had the ability to go into samadhi. He would bury himself for days at a time in these airtight rooms that could be proven to be airtight, and he could prove you don't need to breathe to live. And he had been, he really liked Alan, and he showed Alan a lot of I don't know how to say, he was very generous with Alan. But when Alan was there at the Kumbh Mela, which is the great religious festivals that happen once every 12 years in India, Alan got very, very sick. So fast track it to the future when I'm with Alan and Swami Kaleshwar, who we met in, I think Alan met him in New York. I first met him in Washington because I was at one of these Ramtha retreats. And I had just heard Kathy O'Brien, who was a sex slave. She was talking the horrifying stuff that she was saying. And I really wanted to address that problem. So when I met Swami Kaleshwar, Sri Sai Kaleshwar Swami from the south of India, this very, very young, handsome master, I said to him straight away, which is like a business deal between him and me, I said, can you heal government mind control? And he said, yes. And he said, come and travel with me and not for a couple of days. And I said, no, I really want to finish up here at the school, because to get to see him, I wasn't given permission by the school. I had to climb over a fence, jump over barbed wire, and hitchhike into town in order to see Swami Kaleshwar, because the person that gave you permission to leave said, you want to miss meeting Ramtha to see a manifesting master from India? No, you don't have permission. And I was used, at this point, I was a millionaire, so I was used to getting my way. But Alan was back in New York, so he was unavailable for me to say, Alan, would you get on the phone and make sure I get, you know, I can leave this school so I can see this master while he was in town? I do believe he was up there probably to visit Microsoft executives. That's my guess right now. Proving that some of these big politicians and very big corporate leaders very much believe in spiritual blessings and power of these masters. So let's see, where should we go from there?
Okay, wow. okay, so that's interesting that
I didn't go for a couple of days with Swami, that most people say, oh, great, private audience, and go with him, because I was so impressed with the Ramtha school, and I like to honor my commitments. I was committed to that school. And so I told Swami, I'll see you in December. This was probably in October. And then my girlfriend, then the airfare was so expensive, I said, I don't really want to spend that much money, even though I've got money. I'm still a resourceful person. I've always been resourceful. So Molly found, my friend Molly, who you definitely have to meet to get the story of Alan complete, she found some cheap tickets. We went to India, and I stumbled on the most stupendous miracle that Swami had ever done, which was making a cross bleed liters of blood. And this was, the people around him had been prepared for months to do this process. They were... They had to do long mantras, and so they resented that somebody like me and Molly, who were just sort of like spiritual tourists, you know, because I was telling Molly, you know, you really don't want to get too involved with the masters, and I just wanted to do a quick pass by on his ashram, and I was really heading on my way down to see Amici in Kerala, because I had a lot of respect for Amici. I mostly did because she would hug people. And I'd seen all these masters, oh, stay away from my energy, don't touch me, don't touch me. And here's this woman that just goes right in and hugs people. I thought that was wonderful. I have a nice connection with Amici. But I never made it down. Swami convinced me and Molly and Alan to stick around. Alan didn't stick around that long, Molly a little bit longer. And I got stuck for 4 years. I really, really did not enjoy being in the ashram. But because I was so much older, and he mostly had younger people, he gave me permission to come and go whenever I wanted. And that permission to come and go was very interesting, because later on, when he was routed out by a bigger guru, and they were trying to shut his ashram down, and I was on one of my typical excursions back and forth, I stumbled on the ashram empty. Only the Indians were left. And surprisingly, they made some calls, and he gave permission from his exiled place to let me in. And I remember going in then, and it was like going through a bombed city. You could see the stress of evicting an entire ashram was really intense. Now, at that time, when I met with Swami in his exiled place up in Hampi, in either Karnataka or Andhra Pradesh, I have to check again, but it was one of the last Hindu strongholds before India fell to the British. In other words, the Muslims never made it quite down to the south, and this was a very important... the architecture was still there, all of the temples and things, and that's where he was when he was evicted temporarily from his ashram. And at that time, my interest was pedophilia and curing pedophilia. And I had gotten the rumors that Satya Sai Baba, the big guru in the south, was a pedophile, and Swami was exactly the right age. He had everything going that he would have been a victim. So Swami said, stand by, there's going to be a lot of action in the newspapers. And I thought, finally, Swami's going to come out and we're going to address this issue. But they must have made some kind of deal behind the scenes, because the issue never came out. Swami did get back into his ashram, but there were these little digs that you would know that he was really under a lot of pressure with the politicians. And one was, they wouldn't give him a license to have peacocks. Now, this means nothing to you or me as Westerners, but a peacock is the tantric shamanic animal that Saraswati rides on. So to deny somebody permission to have peacocks in their ashram is a real slap in the face, and it's a kind of a saying, you know, don't get out of line. And these were little things that I watched and I picked up, and just because I don't miss, and I would like to get it on camera. There, you know, sometimes I speak too fast, too loose, too freely, and I should be more careful. The only time I really regret not speaking my mind was when some politicians came in the ashram, and one of us Westerners, a guy named Thomas, was serving Swami, and you could see these politicians were disgusted to see this little thin, you know, very dark-skinned man, because there's a kind of a discrimination. The darker the skin, the more you're looked down on. And I really wanted to say, but didn't say it. What's the matter? You never saw a white man kiss a black man's ass? You know, that's what I'd really want. And I feel if I had had the courage to say it, probably Swami would have seen that I was ready to come into his confidence to learn about politics, the dark side of politics, and how politicians can really hold down beautiful masters. Because at the time of this eviction from his ashram was exactly the time on the political scene when it looked like India and Pakistan were at loggerheads, and nuclear bombs were coming into the picture. Now, fast forward to Jane Goldberg, and when I worked with her in radiation hormesis, I have a very different opinion about radioactivity and nuclear bombs. But at that time, it really seemed to me, if the politicians can't respect their saints, woe is that society. And so, you know, there was never nuclear bombs sent back and forth between India and Pakistan. But this brings to mind the importance of Pilot Baba, because Pilot Baba was flying over Pakistan, dropping bombs. He was in the Indian Army, and as a Hindu, he still realizes, why am I dropping bombs on my fellow man? And they hide it from the West, but Pilot Baba is a prince from Bihar. And Bihar is one of the most corrupt states in India. It's so corrupt that when, you know, these marauders jump on the train, the ticket collectors jump off. They just let them have whatever car they want. And when I was traveling through one of these cars, one of these, you know, marauders, these gangsters came on the train, and I was sleeping, and I loved sleeping on Indian trains. I would go into these really sublime states. So I did not like being disturbed. And so here was this gangster with his entourage and me, and I'm squaring off with the gangster, pretty much assuming that there's a ticket collector around, not knowing that even the ticket collectors are afraid of him, and saying, where's your ticket? And you can see these little guys watching their ringleader and watching me and watching, and finally the ringleader backed down and these guys left, and it was a very crowded train. And I let one little Indian guy share one of the bunks with me. But it gives, I just want to emphasize that Pilot Baba is a prince from Bihar. And he has in his blood a feeling for caring for the people. So later on, when he encountered an immortal in the Himalayas, I absolutely believe it. He encountered an immortal. And he told the immortal, he said, look, I don't have a lot of time to serve you and prove my devotion. If you have any gift for me, lay it on me. And they laid it on him. He had the ability to go into samadhi. And later on, when he met a very worthy yoga student from Japan, he took her, she's Yogamata, directly to his master. And she got her power from his master, not from Pilot Baba. So in some parts of the world, it's Yogamata that's known more than Pilot Baba. But I, through Alan, have the connection to Pilot Baba, obviously, as his consort, wife, whatever you want to call it. I have huge regard for Yogamata. But it's my fervent, heartfelt wish that we can get the politicians and the judges and the lawyers or whatever organized enough so that Pilot Baba can do in the West this huge blessing and gift that he got from an immortal in the Himalayas right here in this country. And I think it could be Woodstock. That's my hope. And I believe that Alan could also be an important part of making this happen. Because what Alan started as a little email list in the East Village of New York grew into new realities and a lot of fame on YouTube, but he has been stolen from. The thieves, the bankers, the fraudsters, they first took away Channel 14 when he was on cable in Manhattan. And he said he was recognized all over when he was on Channel 14. And then when they moved it to Channel 34, I mean, you're talking in a primitive way when there was a dial that used to go up from 1 to 15, or you know, it wasn't going very far. So when cable was bringing it up to 34, that was like a huge amount of choices. So you're like relegating somebody to the dustbin. But even years go by, and new realities builds up and builds up. And pretty soon, they steal from him. They put him on to Channel 56, which is a spiritual channel. But still, it builds up. It still builds up. And so Alan was stolen, Channel 14, Channel 34, by Manhattan Neighborhood Network itself, and then put to Channel 57, I think, which was then sold to Al Jazeera. This was happening in the last year or so. And all the traffic goes with it. So Alan could, just by force of his own personality, ability, and legacy, he could build it up again. And he could reclaim what is rightfully his. But he has to stand up for it. And if you can edit this out if you want or not, but if you want to get into any sensitive area about my relationship with Alan, it's because my soul was going into a direction that I needed to stand up for what was taken away. And Alan is very much not into rocking the boat. And I believe that the Tantra, or Paramashiva Yoga, because Tantra is so misunderstood, what Swami Kaleshwar was trying to teach us in the south of India and wanted us to go to his ashram and, you know, and to learn, was that you have to go into the areas that are very uncomfortable and very rocky. Later on, when I got into 9/11 truth, it was because two people in my building in Gramercy Park died in 9/11. And although I didn't want to get involved with political stuff, why would I want to do that? I want to know God. I want a cosmic consciousness. I don't want to deal with political corruption. But a DVD came in my mailbox. And I put it on after I watched an hour of Krishnamurti with another guy. I remember he's since dead, an old-timer that Alan knows. They used to go exploring for crystals. This guy was really interesting guy. And he was watching Krishnamurti with me. And I said, and I had a projector, and we were projecting it up on my white wall. And I said, hey, you want to look at this? I really... You know, it's kind of like my civic duty to learn about 9/11. And I'd expected it would be at the most an hour long. It was a three-hour DVD, and it was a conference. And in that conference, there was a scene where you could see the towers, you know, exploding, and the way the cascading smoke was going. This was no airplanes knocking some building down with some fire. you could see this was, as I was watching it on my wall, because I wasn't here during 9/11. I was in an ashram in India during 9/11. So I didn't go through the same mind control that Americans went through when they watched fabricated footage on television. I was away from it. So I did, in my 4 years, come back, and I visited the site for sure, and obviously I knew about it, but I didn't see that footage. So when I saw this footage, I remember being on my bed in Gramercy Park, and I'm just watching, and I'm going, and I'm feeling the kundalini coming up, and it was just, and I go, wow. And then I was hooked, you know, and then 9/11 Truth came along. And I had tried to get it. When I came back from India after 4 years, I was no longer a millionaire. I thought I was going to come back to $100 million because I was invested in telecommunications in China. So I was going to make even more money than I made. I made $5 million with a $30,000 investment when I was in California that came from my little wicker furniture store. That's where my little $30,000 came. And I'm not a risk taker. I'm not a gambler. But I entered the lottery because $30,000 was not enough money for me to put as a down payment on my store. Because at that time, China was going to take Hong Kong. And Hong Kong money was coming over and buying real estate in California, which was making it go up so high that your average shop owner couldn't possibly buy it. Not to mention another $100,000 worth of earthquake reinforcement that I would have to do. It was impossible. So having saved $30,000 was practically worthless. So when I started to learn about cellular telephone and how the government was going to give away licenses, I said, hey, deal me in. This was like I had a 1 out of 3 chance of getting a license that was of enormous value. Our company sold for $20 million and it should have sold for $60 million.
Wow. okay.
I know.
Let's see. Ooh, my leg keeps falling asleep.
I know. I wanted you to. How much have you shot?
I don't know. A lot. I have got half this battery left, and I'll have to be mindful of the light.
I know. Let me check mine.
Okay.
Oh, we've shot 1 hour and 7 minutes.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Okay, I'm all ready.
Okay.
Let's talk about the Divine Mother, maybe, so you can at least get a shot up there. Because yeah. I want you to... This is a power object.
I got that. But let me make sure. Okay. So I definitely want to know more about how you met Alan, and just share with me your impressions of who Alan is.
Okay. I met Alan through Ada Citron, and Ada Citron was studying Mantak Chia's Qigong, sexual tantra, really, with a man named John Lupos. John Lupos was giving lectures or seminars, and Vincenzo, I was married to a Sicilian, he was the cook of John Klein, and John Klein was taught me Advaita Yoga. He was the one that said that meditation isn't something you do 20 minutes two times a day, that meditation is something all day long. And I thought, either Jean Klein doesn't know what meditation is, or he's saying something incredible. Well, I realized he was saying something incredible. And on a yoga seminar with Jean Klein, I met Vincenzo, who was Jean Klein's cook. At that time, Jean Klein was quite elderly, maybe in his 80s, and he had cancer. And he said that Vincenzo had healing hands, and that's why he wanted Vincenzo to be his cook. So despite Vincenzo's healing hands and our 7-year marriage, it was sexually dysfunctional. And so I had hopes that, you know, by learning more about, you know, sexual tantra, it could save our marriage. And so at this conference, I remember when the men and the women were separated, they showed the men some exercise where they where they tie silk cloth and hang weights from their penis. And I thought, here's my, you know, Vincenzo was so innocent. He didn't even know what a Jew was. You know, that's how isolated he was. Everybody was Catholic in Italy. And his father, his family was from Sicily, but his father sold lemons, and he was an incredible salesman. He went up to Torino, that's where they have the Shroud of Turin in the north, and he, through selling lemons, became quite wealthy, and then of course they retired to Sicily because they discriminate in the north against Sicilians. So I said to Vincenzo, I go, well, I didn't know that this was going to happen in the lecture. I said, well, what did you do, Vincenzo? He goes, well, what could I do? Everybody else was doing it. But I could see he was empowered, you know, so that was a good thing. Well, Vincenzo had come back from a conference in Australia because, you know, I had made a lot of money. I thought $5 million was a lot of money, but believe me, you can spend it fast. And it was mostly bad investments that I lost it on. But he was at a permaculture conference in Australia, and he fell in love with someone. So he had come to New York to tell me that he was in love with someone. And I was trying to save our marriage, and I said, here, let's take this lecture, this seminar with John Lupos. So we took it with John Lupos. I met Ada Citron. And then when Vincenzo did leave me, I was staying at Central Park South. There was a hotel there. And I, even though I had the money to stay in a hotel, I was so heartbroken about Vincenzo leaving that Ada invited me to stay in her place and I could sleep on her sofa. And it was just my heart was hurting so much. So Ada had found out what I was interested in. Oh no, at that time, John West, the man who did Mystery of the Sphinx, do you know about that, the water erosion on the Sphinx? I was hooked up with them. So I was introduced to the people who produced that. And that was an Academy Award winner for, it got the best documentary for research. And obviously these people would charge a lot of money to do any video production. But I was just amazed at their library. They had a lot of things on crop circles and stuff. But at that time I realized, you know, I better start making this charity be sustainable. So Alan had come over either to interview me or something, and you know, God bless Alan for seeing an opportunity. He knew I had some money and he had some ideas, and he gave me a very extremely reasonably priced offer to start doing video work. So I started to do that, and he took me into the public access studios. Alan really discovered me. Alan put me in front of the camera. Prior to that, I would have felt the proper way to do this is to hire real actresses, but I didn't know how to do any of that on my own. So just as a last ditch, you know, effort, I did it myself. I actually remember being on the graphics, the computer generator to put titles, and I had to come up with a name for myself. Well, I got a Greek last name. You know, how are you going to say Paula Tsakonas? Who's going to... I've even been told by my cousins in Greece, I don't pronounce my last name correctly. So I put on my middle name, which I never even really liked, which is Gloria. I just put on Paula Gloria. It happened that fast. And so Alan got me, you know, he took me into the studios. When I walked in, I felt like I was in a cathedral. I felt that holy feeling. That's how I met Alan.
Okay. And how did your relationship develop?
At that time, I was John West's girlfriend. And John West made it clear he would not get involved with me unless it was an open relationship. Well, I was hurting so much with this marriage and Vincenzo leaving. I said, fine, you know, I never tried that. Maybe that'll be a good thing. But as somebody pointed out, usually when a man says they want an open relationship, they want it open for them, you know, not open for the woman. So when Alan came along, I actually remember eating with Alan because I paid for everything. We were always going out to eat, and I used to spend $10,000 a month prior to Alan, you know, with me and Vincenzo traveling around Europe. just on my American Express, you know, just taking, because we went out, John Klein, that wonderful, wonderful man in my life, he introduced me to bankers in Switzerland, and he introduced me to really good food, you know, so we ate in the finest restaurants. I was spending $10,000 a month on food. So when Alan and I went out to eat, I remember asking Alan, are you gay? I asked him that. And so, you know, he said no or whatever. And then the next day in my apartment, he was very aggressive with me. Well, Alan had gone home, called Ada up, and he said, well, what should I get involved with Paula or not? You know, so he kind of made a business decision about whether this would be a good idea. And I myself had so much heartache over being rich and being poor and watching how money affected a relationship that I actually do remember telling Alan, you got to choose my bed or my money, because I fully intended it to be a one-night stand, and so did Alan. We never really thought, but, you know, it worked out fairly nicely. I do see in retrospect, and I think Daniel Kavasanke would be the one that would give much more insight if you wanted to explore that, that in many ways I never understood Alan and he didn't understand me. So.
Interesting. So.
And I often wonder if it's the Jewish thing, you know, because I was German descent. My mother was German and my father was half Greek, but his mother was Austrian. So he spoke German. And he was able to sell a little stuff to the Nazis when they were there. But because he was speaking German, he would obviously be suspect. So when through his businessman father, he discovered that he was on some kind of list, he hightailed it out of Athens. And you know where the refugees are coming in through Syria? He did it the other direction back in that day. And he eventually made it to Palestine or somewhere there in the Middle East. And the British, because he went to a very good school in Athens, you know, and we're all profiled, you know, this profiling isn't a new thing. He became a pilot for the British. So they taught him how to fly. And he was eventually deployed to Rhodesia. But I remember the huge disappointment, you know, when I was growing up in Berkeley, to hear that when he encountered a German airplane, he ran the other way. And you know, I found out because the Germans had better airplanes and he knew he would lose, but I thought, oh, shoot, you know, my dad could have been a hero and he ran the other way. And plus, I'm so ashamed of being German because here I am in Berkeley, California, and, you know, most of my friends are professors' kids and most of them are Jewish. And they're very educated, very refined, very cultured. You know, they're playing the cello and the violin, and you know, And I always admired how, in a Jewish household, the women were so respected. You know, they just ran it. You know, whereas my mother, when my father and her would have arguments, she would run off and she'd be crying. You know, I remember as a kid feeling so bad that my mother's crying. And what it was is, again, there was a kind of a misunderstanding. She's German, you know, even though California third generation, there's a kind of a Nordic reserve. And my father is, you know, at least half, you know, of a Mediterranean. And they're, you know, in a Greek household, you know, among Greeks, you don't call up and say, hey, I'm coming over. You drop in. But you know, northern people are offended by that. You know, little things like that, you know, really add up. So, and I remember Alan coming out to see our family, and he's talking to his family. He goes, well, I met Paula's family, and they're smart, you know, as if everybody who's not Jewish isn't smart. So we have these stereotypes of each other. But sometimes the stereotypes do have some merit. So I oftentimes understand, particularly now as I'm learning more about law, more about the bar, and more about how many Jews do get involved with the law and the bar. And I'm seeing, you know, there's an argument both ways. There's an argument, like for example, recently Alan got Channel 57 stolen from him. But when Gail Brewer, the borough president, who's very responsible for this theft, he doesn't want to rock any boats, and so he'll take a survey and he'll say everything's fine. You know, so that would just drive me crazy. Alan, everything's not fine. You just got ripped off. But he is smart because he's seeing that what you're up against is enormous. But then again, if you're really believing in new realities, and you've got the divine on your side, and people are suffering as a result of not standing up, are you going to be abandoned by the divine? It's almost like it's almost like the Jewish intelligence realizes, well, you know, I could take the law up to this point, but you know, these aren't really real stories. But I believe them. I believe they are really real stories. And I believe that in any tradition, you're going to have masters. In the Jewish tradition, it will be the Baal Shem Tov. Did you study that, the Baal Shem Tov? The Baal Shem Tov is like what you would call a siddha in Indian terminology. A siddha is a master of the cities. You know, he can make things levitate. Or my husband now, who was a Vietnam veteran, he did read Maharishi's book, you know, in his 4 years in the Navy. He watched a Vietnamese village get blown up, and at that point he had this incredible experience where he said it was like a channel being changed. First he saw the Vietnamese village, then he saw a suburb in New Jersey, then he saw the Vietnamese village, suburb in New Jersey, and he said, just a second, we're killing innocent people. And this is always a deep shock to a veteran. So when he came home, he was only 21 years old. You know, they shipped him off to the Army at 17, or the Navy at 17, because he stole a car. And the girl that he stole it for, she goes, I didn't know you knew my uncle. And it turns out he had stolen her uncle's car. So they filled it with gas and they took it back. And then the uncle called up and he dropped the charges. But they said, too late, you can't drop the charges, and the kid has to go into the military. So he went in at a very young age. So at 21, when he's out, this is the height of the psychedelic movement. He's taking LSD and he's starting the communes. And, you know, I can't remember how I got onto that track, but maybe it'll come up again.
Yeah, actually, I'm trying to remember, too. Well, okay, so, Alan...
Oh, he wouldn't stand up, so...
Yeah, so, well, what do you think were you say that you didn't understand each other, really?
Right.
When you were together? What do you see now that you didn't know then about your relationship, or...
That I think that just because a Jew says that he believes airplanes brought down the towers during 9/11 doesn't necessarily, he means he really believes it. And this is something that I really liked Alan's mother. And I remember being with Alan and his mother once when Alan was, you know, doing his thing. And Alan's mom goes, you don't really believe that, do you? You know? And part of this, I think, kind of devastated Alan because Alan does believe. But part of it, you know, just having survived, you realize there is a lot of phoniness. But if new realities is your shtick, you kind of have to give a certain amount of professional courtesy to everyone and not call everybody a liar if they're a liar. And me and say, you know, Joe, who I was telling you about, when he was involved in the psychedelic movement, and LSD and all that was happening, in his commune, they were rehabilitating heroin addicts. So, you know, so the hippie movement had a side to it that I never saw. The media never relayed. These people were doers. They were activists. They were going out and you think, well, you don't want to hear about the Vietnam War. You just want to, you know, have peace, love, and rock and roll. But Joe had always been responsible about the war. And getting out of it, to be able to blend both of those. Alan, I don't think, would really want to get involved with things, activist things like that. His interest in bank fraud only went as far as his own student loan problem, which is a big problem, you know. People, you know, you saddle people with big debt, they should learn about it. But I don't think Alan's debt was that big at that time. But now, you know, I feel so sorry for, say, an editor, a Final Cut 7, Daniel Kavasanki spent $27,000 to get his education. All of a sudden, Final Cut 7 isn't being supported, and he's got the debt for that. That should be fought. That should, you know, you shouldn't stand by and just ignore it. But Alan can keep rolling with it. He can keep rolling with it. Likewise, his brother. His brother had a really successful software company going before 9/11. After 9/11, everybody's in such shock. It was really, you know, you remember the dot-com bust? It was a big shakedown because people were creating an artificial reality on the internet, and they still are. And even to this day, there's a controversy about the name Woodstock. Just something like that, because they want to own the name Woodstock so that the whole world will always be interested in this epic event in 1969 that can only be paralleled with, say, the Kumbh Mela in India. But in India, it's grandfathered in. Every 12 years, even saints that have nothing to do with politics will come down from their, you know, little caves and places, and they will interact with the people. And they'll show them their cities, and they will demonstrate. But here, you know, when Joe had his free festivals, when they thought nobody would be interested in Woodstock festivals after 69, he showed it was not true. For $100 that Joe took out of his pocket to start building a stage and getting some musicians up, the momentum got going until he had 10,000 people, you know, showing up. And then the money people come in, and then they want to clamp down what the real message is. The real message is, ladies and gentlemen, in 1969, they were smoking marijuana. In 1969, at this festival that had 500,000 people, they were taking LSD. But if you go to the Bethel Museum, they've expunged this from the record. And now what do you have in its place? A heroin epidemic. We're sitting right in the middle of a heroin epidemic because heroin's cheaper than marijuana. You could take, you know, Joe told me about making love with a girlfriend and being out in nature, and they had this spot over the freeway that was very remote. You couldn't get to it easily. And he threw out some pot seeds, and, you know, 6 months later when he's with there, lo and behold, there are his plants. And I don't even know if he was intending to plant them. They were just maybe annoying him in his joints, so he tossed them out. That's how easy you can just grow a plant and then share a plant and have people decide among themselves how to responsibly use it. And now what do you have? You have kids taking these dangerous pharmaceuticals, and really the police not knowing what to do. They have some kind of drop-off for it. But these are political topics, and Alan doesn't want to deal with that. And I want to deal with whatever I have to deal with to get to the healing that I want to get to. And so I know that if we pave this and set this up correctly, perhaps, you know, given the power of this auspicious encounter, you know, Alan would feel comfortable to be involved. And Alan, too, would regain the stature that he deserves. You're an exceptional soul that happened to find him, but he is being contained. That the power of his message is being contained. I do think that he was, what do you say, you become jaded. I think when Jay-Z Knight said that she was going to take us out to Tavern on the Green after he did so much free publicity for her, she didn't even take us out to lunch. And I think that really, it got to Alan to a point that I think made him, I think, a little bit jaded. So it was like he can play it very carefully about what he really believes in versus what he's just promoting. You see what I'm saying? And that's not to speak against him for promoting, because you have to survive. And that's what I'm saying is, if I was judgmental for some of the moves that Alan made, it was because I wasn't in as difficult a position as he was in. I could keep throwing money at things, and when I ran out of money, I just kept throwing my heart into it. So when I got a daily show on Manhattan Neighborhood Network, I didn't have money anymore, but I was filled with huge enthusiasm from India. YouTube was just happening, and I put my stuff up because I said, hell, you know, I've run out of money. I don't know any other way to get this fantastic message out of higher states of consciousness. Let me give it away free. And everybody said, Paula, you're a fool. Don't give it away free. But, you know, there I was with all the high school kids dancing in their bedroom, but it was working for me. And then pretty soon all the people who scolded me for giving it away free were realizing, oh my God, she's got 3 million hits, then, you know, then now 5 million, but I'm really being contained right now. But I'm learning about it. And part of that learning is, you know, Daniel was the one that really, really showed to me how much I didn't understand Alan. And it started with him not understanding me. So, in other words, I told you my story about transcendental meditation and how, you know, I wanted, these men in prison were being helped. Why was the state of California, that's purportedly about rehabilitation, not doing anything? And the reality is so ugly that it took decades for me to be mature enough yet to comprehend it. And that is that we have an industry incarcerating people. And it's going to be mass incarceration, and it's going to make all of what we've heard about happening in World War II and the Nazis and the Germans and the Jews seem like nothing compared to what's happening right now. And I still, as a child, I said, if I was a German, I would have spoken up, I would have spoken up. I still feel like that, exactly feel like that today. And it's happening worse today, and I am speaking up. Thank you for listening.
Yay!
And I love your background. I mean, you have a story too on all of this. You're descended from Holocaust survivors. You have a huge story.
Yeah. I actually made I was going to send you a link to a documentary I made about my grandfather's cousin who survived in Vienna and never left, and stayed there and helped rebuild the community. And through the 80s, through the 90s, he was helped. It was this teeny tiny little Jewish community, but there was still this rampant anti-Semitism, but all sort of under the surface.
Yeah, right.
And
right.
So that was kind of.
But see, you have to clarify what you have to be clear on your definitions. You have to, first of all, define anti-Semitism. You have to define, you know, what is a Jew? Is Ashkenazi or Sephardic? I mean, I was shown, I grew up in a Greek community because of my father, and one guy was teaching, he was a professor of medicine at UC Medical Place in San Francisco, and his wife, we knew, was Jewish. She was the only one Jewish. Well, she was 16 years old when she left Rhodes, the island of Rhodes. She was Sephardic Jewish. And she showed me photographs that completely changed my notion of Jews living in ghettos. These people were gifted translators to the Sultan, and they had mastery of many languages. Her brother could learn a language and speak it like a native. You would never know, no accent, nothing. And to see the elegance of and the finery of their chinaware and the lace that they were wearing, and they witnessed horrors, because who's going to be more dangerous if you're trying to spin a myth than the translator? You know, so
true.
So it was there's a story there that's so deep, and people are so. On both sides, on all sides, Germans and Jews, you know, who've gone through this, there's so much misunderstanding that's creating such a wedge to really solve the problem. The truth was there was a great culture between the Germans and the Jews. All of that was destroyed. I had, you know, a friend, she was a little bit older, and she worked at she was a mathematician at UC Berkeley. And she said that her mother never forgave her father for taking her away from the land she loved. And I thought, well, just a second. If all of the Germans were all about killing Jews, wouldn't you be happy to leave Germany? But that wasn't the full story, you see? And I'm certain you learned a lot from your grandparents on that.
Yeah, yeah, it's funny. I've heard that a lot, that some people just have this deep love for Vienna. They, you know.
My grandmother was from Vienna.
Yeah, so. Yeah, but the Viennese Jews, even now, some of them, some Holocaust survivors, still had that deep love for their home. And some, you know, never wanted to go there again.
Right,
but
right.
I just have to change a battery.
Sure. I should probably change mine, too. I think this is okay.
Yes. So you've said a lot of interesting things.
So have you.
Thank you. I'm curious about the Ramtha element, because you think that there's... Well, you said two things that make me wonder if you got a sort of a mixture of messages from Ramtha or through that experience.
Well, let me tell you, first of all, what Sri Sai Kaleshwara Swami said about it. He was meeting with people when I suspect he was up. See, through my connection, George Sobel, who set up this, you know, he kept saying, you got to meet this master, you got to meet. And I said, you know, I'm so tired of the masters. I'm doing my millionaire thing, saving the world. So he set it up. He said he's in Yelm, Washington. I said, this is a great opportunity. I can just see him easily. Swami said when he was reporting back to the ashram, he said, in the Northwest, I have met the purest souls up here, the purest souls. But he also said that Ramtha was teaching black magic. But now, what is black magic? That's what I'm saying, you know. It's, you know, because here was this Catholic priest. A lot of people can say, you know, Catholicism is black magic too. You know, there's an argument for any kind of structured religion. Is it magical that you have convinced people that there's some kind of regime that you have to subscribe to in order to be worthy to be before God, you know? So who knows? Some of my most stupendous experiences happened at the Ramtha School, so I'll never deny that. I'm just saying, on a personal level with Alan, I just kind of think that he was hurt, that he wasn't taken more into the inner circles, or at least respected enough to be taken out to lunch at the Tavern on the Green. But I also know that the reason that they didn't want to give me permission, and the reason they had barbed wire around the place, is they didn't want a bunch of drunk people going into the town, making it any worse for them, because they just wanted to be a collection of people that wanted to do what they wanted to do. And everybody who consents to come in there should be able to do that, as long as nobody's hurt. So I can see it all ways. I can see why you have to have rules and regulations, and I can also see how there's people like me that can't be contained by fences. I did it again at Swami's ashram. I jumped over the fence and I went up to the top of a mountain because I was sick in the ashram. I the way the energy was, it just didn't work for me, and I longed to be healed. And even now, I got rid of my own cancer using black salve. It's a 2,000-year-old formula of bloodroot, galangal, graviola, and chaparral. And probably there could be other variations on the combination, but bloodroot's the most important. It attacks only the, you know, the cancer cells, or in the case of gangrene, any abnormal cell, and it leaves everything else alone. But it's a painful process. It hurts because the cancer creeps around. And so, you know, when you're asking about Ramtha, was it a good thing? Did it really happen? Was it a bad thing? I know Howard Stern really spoke badly about it. But Howard Stern was also a TM person. But I know, having been on Howard Stern, you know, when I did the 9/11 truth and I started to get so much attention on the internet, Howard Stern had me come on his show. But I also know Howard Stern was a serious transcendental meditator. But, you know, why restrict yourself to one thing? And Swami said, the gurus that have came to the West never told the students, for two reasons, how they achieved their stature. And the two reasons were, either they didn't think the students were mature enough, or they were selfish. Now, if they didn't think their students were mature enough, the argument for that is, you can relay tremendous energy sexually. So it's not that the guru is a sexual predator if he has sex with a student. In some circles, this would be considered a high honor. But you can definitely see how it could be abused, for sure. So, you know there's no easy answers on any of this. If you're trying to get into the high energies and you're trying to do really powerful healing, then, you know, you get into... So in other words, if Alan wasn't invited into the inner circles, it could be that it was perceived that he couldn't handle some of the politics that could have involved local corruption at the town board. God knows we're going through it here. And I told my husband recently, because part of healing myself of cancer is recognizing the cancer thought in me. It was like I took on too much, too fast, more than I could process, probably what many people were always trying to tell me. But until I faced it myself, I couldn't see that. So part of what makes the cancer thought come up for me is I don't like to see people as swindlers and cheaters. And a lot of times when they get involved with some kind of illegal business maneuver, they don't really quite understand the implications of it. They don't see how that's related to concentration camps or internment camps. We're building them at a huge rapid rate right now. It's after you sweep people off the desirable real estate, then you got to put them somewhere to prepare this desirable real estate that you just stole from these people who actually lived there through a maneuver that's not impossible to understand, but most people don't want to take the time to understand it, or they don't want to understand it, because after they understand it, then they're going to have a responsibility. Well, maybe it really wasn't like what we heard in Germany, but I believed the PR. So I believed I was descended from really bad people that did really cruel things to the Jews. So when I had my first crush in sixth grade with Jonathan Rychek, you know, his father was a Jewish professor, but he certainly wasn't any stereotype of the passive, you know, scholarly Jew who is working behind the scenes and is kind of playing both sides or whatever. I remember, you know, when the girls and the boys, when the bell rang for recess, only one or the other could get the ball, so one or the other would grab it. Well, Jonathan had grabbed it, and, you know, I don't know if you remember this, but they used to have these bars that you'd hit the bar and the door would open, and the glass was safety glass. It had like chicken wire in the glass, and that was, I guess, to keep the glass from shattering. Well, Jonathan didn't hit the bar. He hit the glass. So his wrist went entirely through the glass, and it tore out his skin. I was standing next to him. I saw Jonathan Rychek's bone, and this boy never cried, not once. So he comes back to school, and he's got a cast, and he's like, the big guy. Well, we had social dancing then. You had a little card, and you would, you know, the guy would say, you know, if he wants to have a dance with you. Well, oh my God, I mean, I had a dance with Jonathan Rychek. It was huge. So somehow I overheard Jonathan or something at sixth grade, and I'm starting to realize that he's talking about Nazis and stuff. And then I realized that I'm a Nazi, and I'm feeling really terrible about this. So that's what I'm saying. To my dying day, I am never, ever going to not speak up if there's something that should be spoken up about. That's what that's done for me. And they can talk about Holocaust denial and, you know, were there 6,000 or whatever. It doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter. What matters is, are people being hurt? Is something wrong happening, and can you do something about it? But to speak up against it, I mean, I was unlawfully evicted from my apartment in Gramercy Park. The judge actually said she would rule on our motions uncontested 2 times in court because we were so fast with coming back with our counter motions. The other side, even their lawyer didn't show up. And even then, you know, talk about a right to face your accuser. I couldn't even face the accuser's agent. The accuser, the guy who stole the apartment, never showed up. And the whole thing was done with a memorandum of understanding between the court system and the police system. And they target people, elderly, I'm elderly now, and people who they feel wouldn't have a voice. So since public access, you sign some paperwork that gets you under this Crown copyright thing. And even though I was grandfathered in, they sent me a certified letter, and I knew if I signed that, that would be contracting. So my daily show got taken down. I no longer had a voice, so I really couldn't explain. And when I talked to one of the neighbors, I realized this must have been what it was like during World War II, because a lot of the Jewish people had property, you know. So if you can convince the public or the community that they were bad or wrong or whatever, or just scare them, just plain scare them. They know that they were good neighbors. They know they were right. They know there was nothing wrong. But oh my God, I don't want them to haul me off either. So I'm sure it's not about gypsies and homosexuals. It was about whoever was speaking up against swindlers. And I think you could have had plenty of very idealistic Nazis who really thought they were doing the right thing, and the others who were taking advantage of it. And so it was a big land grab, a property grab, and for sure an intellectual property grab, because there was enormous cultural contributions that was done. That was the most devastating thing. So it wasn't about Jews. It was about bankers. And it wasn't even about just any bankers. It was about swindling bankers. It was about people who knew they were doing wrong and that it would have massive effects on people. That's why I think Sigmund Freud, at the last part of his life, his interest was in mass hypnosis, how you can convince entire populations of untruths. So I don't know if that's new realities or not.
Yeah.
But I do know that Alan did have an interest in Ashkenazi Jews and Sephardic, and it really would be nice if you had more spiritual people that really take a look at it and really look at the religion itself. So I think right now, even though people think I'm married to an old hippie, you know, pot dealer, I truly think he's a reincarnated rabbi, because he really feels the law and he does not flinch for all these little maneuvers and little tricks. I'm changing one word of the Constitution. He goes, just a second, you know. All of the productive people in this town, the contractors and retail shop owners, they're making assumptions that there's not cheating going on in the courts. So if you show that there's cheating going on in the courts, now the next step is, what do you do with the judges? So now I'm thinking a penitentiary means a place where you go to be penitent, to be remorseful about what you caused. So maybe, you know, when the warden of San Quentin Prison recently called in and we talked about teaching transcendental meditation in prison, maybe in my future I'm going to be teaching meditation to judges who didn't make the right ruling. Or in a way, you know, you're supposed to have a proper eviction notice that's supposed to be signed by a judge, but the eviction notice has to be issued by the harmed party. So the landlord somewhere has to have a signature there. None of that was there. There was no judge's signature even there. There was some clerk's signature. It was phony. It was fraudulent. But, you know, to start to address it is quite a task. And that's why I'm saying, you know, getting back to the cancer profile, I told my husband, because he was talking about one incredible fighter, Lydia Raiden. And I said, you know, Lydia comes in wired, and, you know, she's recording things. And I said, Joe, I don't want to look at people like they're criminals, and I don't want to set them up. And I don't want to be stupid, because obviously you get chewed up if you don't know what they're up to. But who I am, I really want to make everybody's soul get bigger. I want them to feel their divine connection. And after I said that, it was like a mental prayer. Boom, it was laid all out to me. I saw exactly how this town board is swindling this town. I saw the whole guy coming over from Seattle, the whole thing with Microsoft, the Google thing. I know the players, but that knowledge didn't come to me. It was psychic stuff. It didn't come to me until I said, I don't want to look on these as evil people, but I want to have the tools to say this is wrong, you know.
Well, do you think that there are evil people?
Well, some people have said you can even shoot up to there. The Divine Mother is the biggest manifestation of the evil. Is that in numerology you have one, there's only one consciousness. So if you get two, then now you have duality. The biggest crime is the crime of fraud, an illusion. If you know, in my board, and I think it happens in a lot of co-ops, they double securitize the leases. Because the banks don't really have the right paperwork in order, and this is quite a big topic to explain. But as soon as you have two, you can have three, four, five, six, you can have 40. So where do you stop it? So they've called the Divine Mother. She's also called Mahamaya. You know that what Maya means? Illusion.
Oh, right.
Maya is illusion. Maha means great. Rishi means seer. Maharishi means great seer. So Maya means illusion, but Mahamaya means the great illusion. So as I started to study this bank fraud and realize the deceptions going on, I realized, wow, maybe this is why they say that the study of the Divine Mother is evil. Because by being two, by being a mirror, and not being pure oneness, one God, and nothing else, that's an illusion, and that's not real. And then you're going to get in trouble because of that. I mean, it's a thought.
But
before I go, I don't want to distract your thought. This is a depiction of the Virgin Mary with the child, and there have been different thoughts. The Rambam school says that Mary, the mother of Jesus, and Jesus were soulmates. This is kind of a bizarre interpretation. Others have said Mary Magdalene was from a royal family herself and was a peer of Jesus's, and what they were trying to do was shed the oppression of the Romans. Swami had said that the experience that people have when the apparitions of the Virgin Mary come is 99.9% the same as the experience he was preparing his students to have. That in other words, that the eyes should be able to see that which is most beautiful, the nose to smell what's most beautiful, to be able to touch, that God can be physical. And so this flies in the face of those that say, no, the divine can only be spiritual, it can never have anything to do with this corruptible world. So when the Virgin Mary appears, makes these appearances, you have these miraculous healings. Now, I was recently reading about it happening in Conyers, Georgia, and then I started reading the medical cases of these people that went through massive chemotherapy. Well, chemotherapy is the only therapy where the doctor gets a cut, and a big cut. So there's a lot of financial motivation for a doctor. Say he's got to get his kid through. Everybody's got financial pressures, right? And when people are having more powerful positions, the temptation will be more powerful. So here are these people who surely are being thrown to the curb, figuring, well, the person's dying anyway. Let's just give him one last round, and I'll put an extra $50,000 in my account. And I've heard this from some of the oncology nurses. They said they had no idea, because it's not ethical for the doctor to take a cut off of a medical procedure, because that will influence the procedure. it just flies in the face of any reason. So she said when she started to discover the amounts of money involved, she started to understand why these decisions were being made. So when I started to look at this, I thought, isn't that interesting? First of all, I've often heard, well, not often, but Joe Friendly, whose real name is Arthur Rubin, it's like my husband Joe said, how come Jews who are so proud of being Jews always change their name? But so Joe Friendly, he says, Christianity is Judaism for dummies, you know? So he goes, when I looked at the amounts of chemo that these people were going through, I thought, are you stupid? Are you stupid to go to a doctor and let him keep doing that to you? Why would you do that, you stupid person? But these are believers. They're so believing in their religion and in their doctor. They believe in their doctor. A doctor, in a way, is like a religious person, because when your body's off, you need to be rectified on all levels, not just giving stem cell therapy replacement that you get from the dead, from the fetuses. Cancer cells and stem cells are very similar. So if you do stem cell therapy, I can see it was offered to me when I was rich. Somebody said, go down to Mexico, get this therapy, you've got the money to do it. And I said, yeah, I've got the money to do it, and you know, you tell me I'll be 10 years younger. But you know, I'm a vegetarian. If I'm a vegetarian, I just don't really see how can I be doing the therapy that involves fetuses, you know, from human beings. And I think maybe they can even do it with pigs now, you know, because it's getting more and more common. Our medical system is so bankrupt that it culminates in organ transplants and these kind of therapies. It's not real medicine. It's not the medicine like Ayurveda and working with plants and this incredible black salve, the elegance with which the cancer is sucked out of your body and with hardly any blood at all. It's like it creates a line, cancer cells here, regular cells there. And it very nicely creates a little cap, and the cap pops off and the cancer's underneath, just boom, like that. And it's so cheap, but there's other stuff with it, because you'll just create more cancer if you don't change the thinking, you know? So again, psychoanalysis, but nobody knows what real psychoanalysis is anymore.
So do you think that all cancer has an emotional cause, ultimately?
Oh, I'm sure of it.
Really?
I'm sure of it. I didn't used to think that before, and I didn't think of how deadly stress is. Because I always thought, you know, I know how to meditate, I know how to decharge. But there comes a point where the body just can't handle it anymore, can't pick up on it anymore. So when these massive amounts of chemo, these people would be healed, I thought, you know what? If the Divine Mother came down and she healed these people who bore enormous pain, she was speaking to their oncologists. Because I don't think they possibly believed these people would have survived. But they went and they got the darshan from the Virgin Mary, or the Divine Mother, whatever you want to call it.
Wow, okay.
And Judaism has all this too. This is not just exclusive to Christianity. There's a very deep notion of the Divine Feminine as having a huge power. When a woman's on her menses, I experienced this firsthand. She, without any intention, she sucks energy. A guy could be doing a spiritual practice for months, and she'll suck his energy away. It happened to me when I was starting to be menopausal. I was sleeping with four women, and one was on her period, and I could feel the energy get sucked away from me. So, therefore, you want to sequester people. But meanwhile, I had a Muslim roommate from Kazakhstan, and she was telling me how wonderful it is to take a break. She goes, when you're on your menses, or no, two wives. She goes, that's great. You know, let the other wife take care of the guy and you can have your peace. You know, so people have worked out, there have been so many permutations and combinations of what makes a good society, but none of them are good on fraud, on deception, on telling a person one thing but actually doing another. And it boils right down to Apple computer. You're selling a computer to an artist, He's paying a lot of money making certain assumptions, not a couple, you know, generations of computers from now. Now he can't plug in his hard drive where he's got all his old files and do the editing.
True. True. That seems to be all greed to me, but maybe you have a different view of it.
That seems to be what?
Greed.
Oh, yeah. Like, yeah, so is there evil? Do you think there's evil?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I think there's...
I didn't believe in evil. Swami asked that. Uh-huh. He said, absolutely, I don't. And he realized, until I did, he was going to hold off on teaching me.
Oh, interesting.
Huh. You know, and now I have a huge respect. Mm. But one of the town boardsmen was talking about the heroin epidemic. He goes, it's an illness. And it was a kind of a counter-transference. You know what that is? When you're really working in deep analysis with a schizophrenic, you can have a thought that you know is not your thought. This guy gets me so angry. And I'm thinking, why do I get so angry? And I realized I should have come back, but I wasn't in touch with myself enough to say, you know, the illness that you're blaming the heroin addicts of having is not as great as the illness of the greed of monopoly that Big Pharma is doing so that these kids can't even have a little pot. And they know you lied to them about pot. So they're not believing what you're saying about heroin or these other dangerous things. You know, that's the illness. Because the town board is protecting a monopoly. And that's what's going to take a lot of skill to bring a guy like Pilot Baba here or wherever. He was all set to go into Samadhi at Columbia University. And at the last minute, they said, it's illegal to hold your breath. And so it stopped. Well, now Joe and I have learned a much deeper level of law, so I feel we could challenge it. And the judges now really know they've done wrong by us. So, you know, I think we could get cooperation there. But it mostly has to be, there has to be a real desire. You know, you ask about Alan and some of the decisions and maneuvers that he's made. A lot of the power of new realities is going to depend on how much of a new reality does a viewer really want to have? Do they want to just have some window dressing, spiritual, feel-good kind of thing? Or do they want to heal their cancer? Or heal, you know, the relationship that an unfaithful husband caused or whatever it might be? Are you really, really wanting to go down there? And I think you have to go down there. I don't think knowing God is for those that believe in God. Is a superficial thing. I mean, there's an argument, too, that there is no authority, that God is choice, that you make a choice in each moment. In each moment, the town board can choose to look at us as a corporate fiction and stay within the parameters that their lawyers say they have to stay in, or just look at the mother crying because her 20-whatever-year-old son died of heroin, you know? You can see the emotional twisting that's happening with the clerks and the chief of police, and, you know, a monopoly is being protected. And that's, you know.
So, with Alan, do you think that there's sort of a split in him? Or, like, how sincere do you think he is about his quest to learn about other realities?
I think he's sincere, but I also think he has a very close connection with his mother, which I think is a really good sign. And when I told you, his mother said, oh, you don't believe in that, do you? Once we were in California with Daffrey John, I don't know what his name is, they changed it. He was a powerful guru. They say he got his power by having sex with the Divine Mother, which is the hardest manifestation to do, at the Vedanta Center in Hollywood. That's where he brought her down and had that encounter. And he's definitely powerful. And he had quite an ashram. I mean, you know, beautiful estate. And I was there... Russell Targ, do you know who Russell Targ is? Okay, we had done some work with him on remote viewing. Russell Targ's daughter, Elizabeth, was a follower of this guy. I can't remember his last name. You can get it in editing, I'll remember it. Doffrey John. And they had a special millionaires weekend. That's what it was really about. They wanted more rich people around. And I fit the category, and Alan is really good at tagging along in situations like that, or, you know, he's smart that way. So, but pretty soon you could see it was really about seeing if you could make a rich person into a devotee. But because I was so gun-shy with my Maharishi experience, I was cautious. So whenever they started, you know, to do the thing where they kind of get consent, I would challenge it. But I would challenge it and become, like, embarrassing to Alan, who would sort of go along with... He wanted to go along with... get along and go along. So, you know, later on, after we were out of that place, he would say, oh, he was like a monster and this and that. But I said, well, Alan, why didn't you say that when I was trying to get out of it? But it was really intense. And there was one point where I actually invoked Alan's mother. I could hear her words saying, you don't believe in this, do you? And it sort of, it was like a lifesaver. You know, it buoyed me through, because there was a lot of heavy energy coming at us. You see what I mean? So I do believe Alan's sincere, but I believe he's very discriminating. He has to be really convinced. And who knows, maybe he's been really hurt in past lives. Molly is convinced she's been burned at the stake. So I can see when we start to edge too close to certain topics, she pulls away, because she suffers from depression. And the antidepressant medication just doesn't work for her. So she just suffers, like, a lot.
Yeah. Huh. So when his mother said, you don't really believe that, was she referring to the 9/11 thing, or...?
No, she was referring to something that Alan was doing. You know, Alan was... He's into all this stuff. So you say, oh, you don't really believe that, do you?
So do you think that's a sort of voice that's always somewhere in his head?
Yeah, and I think it's a good thing. I think you really should have a really strong ruler up and measure things and to say, is this really so or not? And any master worth his salt will only encourage that. Because how could truth not stand up to any type of scrutiny? And I think it would be a really discriminating person that you would open your heart up most to, because I also believe, along with being given power, you're given responsibility. So you would not only want a smart person, but you'd want a generous person.
And you and Alan are still in touch with each other?
Yeah, yeah. But but he has to scramble really a lot, and, you know, there's not much... Unfortunately, our world is so busy. It's not that often you get a chance like what we're doing now, to just take time and sort of reflect on this and put it all together. Not to mention upping the ante. I mean, I think the only thing that could justify bringing Pilot Baba here is, alongside with him going into Samadhi, is we would invite the other religious leaders to say, you can't expect 5 people on the town board to take the whole brunt of the corruption that's going on. You've got to have a lot of people looking at this, and to say, we don't want bank fraud, we don't want deceptive contracts. But it's so entrenched. It goes back to 1933, and some people say eternity. Hmm. You know, when you talk about evil.
Hmm. And Pilot Baba was, you both knew him individually before you met? You
no,
and Alan?
No. Oh. No, Alan introduced me to Pilot Baba. And I do believe Pilot Baba was as generous as he was with his time with me because of Alan. But when Pilot Baba comes to town, Alan, I think wrongly said he didn't feel any juice from him. But I think that's because Pilot Baba pulled back, because he wants to see Alan perform more. Not necessarily perform for him, but for Pilot Baba to give Alan any more energy than he has also creates a type of burden, because you don't just give the power, you also give a responsibility. What's Alan going to do with it? You know, I know what I want to do with it, but I also see that Pilot Baba, he even told me that. He said, I don't want to get you in trouble by trying to arrange it for me to go into samadhi, you see. But I went down, you know, I mean, the next step would be is, let's see about euphoria yoga. I'm just getting to learn to know the lady there. That's where I was initially suggesting we do a shoot. And she was all for it, you know. She was, she wants to make that happen. But, you know, she's got an enormous overhead. You wouldn't think that in a place like Woodstock, for not that big a space, it's $2,200 a month. That's a lot of yoga classes. And there's a lot of people who just don't have that kind of money, and they're suffering because of it. Meanwhile, you've got this fake federal money coming in, fake federal funding, that they're throwing at the heroin epidemic, when we have martial artists and we have real masters living here. And they're at the food pantry too. You know, they can't get a venue or a space. So what's happening is they're turning this place into a kind of a parking lot. And I think they want to secure the copyrights on Woodstock and various permutations and combinations of Woodstock. Woodstock healers, Woodstock artists, and that all has to go through one central place that might decide, hey, you know, this is chopping into our chemotherapy revenue. They're not going to want that kind of healer speaking. But right now, we have a chance we could do it, just with ourselves. So I was envisioning a town hall meeting where we could introduce people to real spiritual practice, and to say, you know, help the teachers, but everybody's going to have to get a lot more mature. So as far as Alan, whether he believes in it or not, or whether he's sincere or not, I think a lot of it depends on his viewers. How much do they really want? If they just want to get laid and get a beautiful woman, and they don't want to admit that they're calling in a prostitute, they'll call it tantra. You know, it can boil down to that. And somebody's even said that Google itself is just a big pimp. You put your hard-earned content on there, and they, through some sleight of hand, take the traffic away. They're pimping you out. You're a prostitute for them. So it's up to you to say, no, that's not what I am. I'm a goddess, or, you know.
But you don't think, so you don't think that YouTube is, in a way, the new public access?
Oh, I think it's always been public access. That's how they justified getting all that bandwidth. They're a service. They're a service provider. It's like with the banks. The banks have what they call the service agreement. They don't have the qualified financial instruments. They don't have the contract with the signature, because what it is you're the beneficiary of a trust, and the trustee is supposed to see that things can take this through bankruptcy until everything works out. So you give a signature to release a certain amount of money. And so what's happening now is the signatures are going down to Washington, and because people think they borrowed money from the bank versus releasing funds from their trust account, they sell them on Wall Street. And it's so YouTube, it's giving you the service to get you on the World Wide Web. That's all it is. It's a service. But it's like a toll, it's like a toll gate. But just because they're charging a toll, shouldn't the toll go back to the people? Shouldn't it be a public road? That's what you, and so what our claim is, and Alan has as much claim as I do, in 2003, I wanted to bring a signal out of Srinagar, out of the Kashmir Valley, but the bandwidth wasn't strong enough to carry that stream. So at the last minute, I took a train maybe 1,000 miles down to Bangalore, and from an internet cafe was able to get a stream going. Or maybe I didn't, maybe it was just my voice. That was the idea, was to get a stream. But Alan was in the studio in Manhattan with a girlfriend of mine that I traveled with. And that proves that we were on the World Wide Web in 2003, that was then relayed through the cable to a live audience. That's called standing. It means that you have claim on whatever develops since then. So for us to be contained, that what they're trying to do is contain the Woodstock producers to not be able to go outside of the Woodstock area. And you're not on the World Wide Web, and I'm just saying, fuck you, you know, because I developed that. My dream is to have a Marshall Rosenberg Center for Nonviolent Communication in Srinagar, Kashmir, and also in the south of India. And using the techniques, you know Marshall Rosenberg's work?
Not really.
Nonviolent communication? Okay. It's really simple. What's most alive in me and what will make life more wonderful? And it goes right back to law. What's the problem? What's the argument? And what's the remedy to make it? You know, a lot of people will go on, they did this and they did this. Well, what do you want to make it better? We're in commercial court, so the only way things are made better is through money. But in the court of public opinion, not everything's money. It's also reputation. And, you know, if you've been cast in a false light, then you've been harmed, and you should have the ability to redeem yourself. Likewise, if the town board is done wrong, you should put them in the stockades and humiliate them at the town green. But, you know, we don't do things that way anymore. But at the same time, I mean, this is the problem everyone's running into. How are you going to put a judge in jail who's related to who's making money off the jails? So you have to rethink everything. But wouldn't it be wonderful to find the people who want to rethink these things? It's like a corporate think tank, minus being paid a whole lot of money by the corporation, expecting a certain outcome. You get people, strong people, you know, of goodwill and smart people and qualified people, to come together with no end in mind, you know, to say, because see, right now as it is, the outcome always has to be, don't expose the fraud. And YouTube has done a lot of fraud. They've definitely stolen. And it's so massive, and people keep going along with it. They keep going along with it.
Hmm. And you, your Manhattan, you're down the rabbit hole.
Farther down the rabbit hole.
What happened exactly with that? So you no longer have...
Farther down the rabbit hole with Paula Gloria was my... how could I say it? The first show I had with Alan was called The Whole Tooth, because it was about the tooth, the whole tooth, and nothing but the tooth. But it began to be everything. It started with my own root canal problem. And then I discovered that mercury was causing problems for people. But I discovered there were 90-year-old dentists who were touching mercury. So I realized mercury couldn't be everything. Then I got interested in Montauk Chia's work and bringing the chi energy through the body, which took me into the area of the sexual yoga or whatever. And then I went to India for 4 years, and then I came home. And all the 4 years in India, I was promoting New Realities Global Public Access. That's what I wanted. I wanted the world to know what public access TV was. Little did I realize while I was in India, the public access I was promoting was being, you know, was dying. It was dying. So when I came back, there was an opportunity. Do you know Democracy Now! With Amy Goodman's show? Mm-hmm. That was launched after 9/11. So since they gave her a daily show, they had to make it look kosher that they were going to give daily shows. So they had one very long-time producer, Harold Channer, and Joe Friendly. But actually they, you know, and if they happen to ever hear this, they're sort of ass-kissers. Or, you know, I mean, I hate to be so coarse and crude, but they wouldn't challenge the corporate structure. And they'd been known for decades not to challenge the corporate structure. I was a loose cannon. I came in, but I was so, you know, people liked my voice, and people were saying they would listen to my dentistry show just to fall asleep. So I looked like a really safe bet. Plus, I'm doing spirituality. That's really safe. They're never going to want to get into any of the fraud stuff. So I kept pushing for a daily show, and I kept being rejected. And finally, Joe Friendly was pulled aside by a lady named Melissa, who shortly after giving me a daily show, quit. So there couldn't be any fallout if she did the wrong thing. Scott Stringer was the borough president at the time. He had come to talk to the producers, and I brought up 9/11 truth. Remember I said when I saw the cascading thing and felt the kundalini coming up? It was like I was committed now. So I said, you know, it's just not right not to look at this. This is so horrible. And Bruce's software company, Alan's brother, he was devastated after 9/11, you know, and he's you know, he keeps reinventing himself, but every time they reinvent themselves, they've lost so much of the equity that they put in. Bruce is a really creative man. So I thought to rectify this. Well, Webster Tarpley, do you know? You probably don't know him. He tends to be a little bit on the right, and he was doing 9/11. So once they found that I was in the hands of Webster Tarpley, then they gave me a daily show, because I was bringing on as an esteemed guest somebody smarter and, you know, more qualified than me to really address these issues. Until a certain point came when Molly said Webster Tarpley was practicing intellectual terrorism against me, because he would never let me consider what if no airplanes went into the towers. That was a taboo direction to go, and I thought, well, if this is free speech, we should be able to explore everything. But it finally came to pass that I had to choose between Webster or the no planes direction. And that's also, if you listen to my interview with Howard Stern, Howard Stern says, I believe two airplanes came into the World Trade Center and knocked them down. But I wasn't hearing the Jewish sarcasm. See what I mean? This is what I mean with when I say I didn't understand Alan. It's like, even if Alan didn't believe that, you know, airplanes went in, he would go along with saying airplanes went in because that's what everybody's believing. You see, now, is that a fault of his or not? I don't know. I used to think it was, and I felt unsupported by him because I felt this is the direction we should go in. But everyone said you're going in a direction that's a brick wall. And so right now, I don't touch 9/11 that much. The closest thing, I think I was fulfilled about 9/11 when I went to housing court and I saw a huge memorial. And I realized that was the beginning of mass eviction of New York City, was to put the shock and awe and trauma of these towers coming down. But it was just, I believe that New York real estate trusts caused 9/11. And they got about 40 outside, probably mostly European contractors to do it. And then they killed a lot of people who knew the details, and everybody else who knew anything close to it kept their mouth shut. So here we are back again. How do you stop the Nazis and the concentration camps and the atrocities? Whether you're Jewish or not, everybody gets sucked in. They become afraid. But when you start standing up, that's why when I saw Joe stand up for his 300 marijuana plants in court against one of the most vicious judges in the county, it was a spiritual experience. I thought, the Jews are right. It's all about law. It's law. But you have to learn it. And then you have to claim it. And then you have to say, I want to be free. And you say, I was born free. I mean, isn't that what it's all about? You say, I'm not a slave. I'm leaving Egypt. I don't belong here. Or, if Egypt was your home, kicking out the guys that tried to swindle you and say, oh, look at what you signed. We own your house now. You know?
It all interconnects.
Yeah, so I really got a feeling of why people wouldn't stand up for Jews in their neighborhood, because they were afraid themselves.
Certainly. Yeah.
Look at it this way. In Kashmir, when I went to a refuge, I was invited to speak at the journalism department in Srinagar. And they're all Muslims. All the Hindus left. They had that crisis happen. Well, right outside of Kashmir is a little refugee camp of all the Hindus, and they're mostly Brahmins. I started using Marshall Rosenberg's nonviolent communication techniques, really simple techniques, but profound and powerful. And I started to hear that the Muslims in Srinagar felt that the Hindus abandoned them, that they left them. And meanwhile, others have the story, oh, these bad Muslims kicked us out. You see, so it's always about a land grab and then going in and seducing mediocre professors and making them feel important. And then they start to go along and say, oh, well, you know, the intellectuals say that this is right. And then you get that fabricated phony science, you know.
So you think that there's lots of conspiracies all the time.
And it's always the same conspiracy, that somebody wants to steal from someone else. But the stealers, because they're stealers and not original content creators, eventually have to either keep stealing more or be revealed or learn how not to steal and come up with their own contributions. And that's what I want to do. I want to show people, don't look on us as adversaries that we figured out your swindle. We could make you even richer if you just give us access to our intellectual property. Let people know we're the ones.
So with M&N, with Further Down the Rabbit Hole, it was your desire
Daily
to
speak. Show.
Yeah. Oh, the Daily Show.
And that's when I went spirituality and politics. I was on camera. I used to go live, and all I had were spiritual types that would call in. Some people say flaky people, because they'll believe anything. And I just, you know, I'm just a believer. I really believe in the healings, even though I never saw the Divine Mother with Swami in India. I did see my soul, and that was a great thing. I believe that the Daily Show, I said, this show is about spirituality and politics. And I remember it was even hard to get the words out of my mouth, because it's such, you're bringing together seemingly the most opposite things you could have. And yet, when you see how much suffering there is over politics, then you do need to address it. And then if you analyze, what does politics mean? It's the study of power. And what is the Divine Mother supposed to be? She's supposed to be Shakti, power. So if you don't study power and understand it, you're going to be oppressed by it.
So is that what was the demise of your show? Basically, that you were...
Oh, my show never got demised. It got kicked off of M&N. I came up to Woodstock, and now M&N, because they sold off their most valuable assets. See, they were going to sell all four channels. They started with 57 because it was spiritual. And I'm sure they regretted losing Alan, because Alan brought them hits. It's all about ratings. But then we came in with, you know, an indication that we were winning our pot bus, and it looked like we were winning the apartment. And so they Time Warner pulled out, because otherwise Time Warner would have lawsuits. Like, you know, if we can prevail and get a voice, we're talking about multi-million dollar assets. And I don't care about the money at all. Why should I?
Even though this was your private residence, how would that have affected Time Warner?
Oh, no, I'm just saying, Manhattan Neighborhood Network, or the people, those criminally minded, those who were going to sell off an asset that really belonged to the public by making it private and then scraping away the producers, and who knows, so many people are losing their homes and rent control and all of that, it starts to go away, so the audience drifts away. You just destroy the community. They were seeing that we were figuring it out through the pot bus and through the foreclosure stuff. And so they pulled back, and pretty soon the ratings started dropping, and they never sold anything. It's gone. I can see it already. There's no hits. M&N, it's not what it used to be. But see, Alan will recreate himself. I know how he is. He'll do it. But if it gets to be such a grind, and he has to do, you know, work that he's only doing to make $100 here and there, it's going to wear him out, and his real genius will never come out. And that's why I fight. for people to have access to the fruits of their labor. Google gives you as little as they possibly can give you. There's no rhyme and reason to what they give you. You don't know how many people are looking at the ads. It's outrageous. And they're going to call for regulation, and they're going to pay off the regulators. But there's a way around all of that if we learn, you know, who we are and our property and, you know, our address and things.
So do you think Ellen mainly lives off the YouTube and the promotion, or is there anything else? How does he live in that apartment? Is it
rent stabilized, so it's very cheap. That's a good thing. But for somebody who's accomplished what he has, he should be able to have a nicer space. But, you know, and I don't mean to sound critical that he won't stand up against the borough president. But because he could be such a star, they really did rip him off. But until he says, I've been ripped off, they're not going to do anything. But he might yet say it. I mean, we are getting, you know, lawsuits going and... But believe me, Joe and I are being very cautious. And what with the cancer profile, I surely don't want to get into anything that's over my head and not happy and healing and wonderful.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it's stress.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I'm absolutely convinced that if Pilot Baba was able to go into samadhi, then you could take the criminality. And you could diffuse it, and you could have that, I don't know what you call repentance. Something magnificent could happen. So I think Pilot Baba was looking for that type of maturity. You know, are the people ready? And Euphoria Yoga is, she's just a wonderful, but young yoga teacher who taught at Jivan Mukti. But what they're doing is they're wearing out people like that. If she doesn't make it, you know, maybe her family gave her a little money to start or whatever. If she doesn't become sustainable, she won't make it. And then somebody else will come in and lose their money, and then somebody else will come in, and they just churn people. And you never really get the community built up. My stepson goes, well, that's outrageous overhead. Surely she can be out of town. But when you're out of town, then you don't have, you know, in a business, it's location, location, location.
Yep.
So.
I think we'll have to wrap up soon, but.
Yeah.
So you said something at the very beginning. You said that you had written a philosophy paper.
Oh, when I was in college?
Yeah, and then everyone laughed.
Yeah, it was like, I could see how they laughed because you could interpret it that way. It was hilarious when you interpret it that way. But the thing is I really meant it. I'd have to wait for that to come back. I haven't thought about it for so long.
Well, I'm wondering if that's ever, is that a recurring theme in your life? I mean, when you take such a stand on some controversial issues.
Oh, yeah. They make me a fool. But that's okay. I mean, that I know is absolutely planned because I know I'm not a fool. You know, and when I get my video assembled and show the cancer coming out, you know, now we go into the town board places. And although what you're saying, you know, that is what Sri Sai Kaleshwara Swami said. He said, all you're lacking is confidence. If you're starting with shame, and look at the shame of being German, then you've got to overcome that. So Joe said, you realize when we went into that supervisor's office to pick up the paperwork, because we're challenging the cost overruns on a remodel of a building of the community center that now has $20,000 a month that it has to come up with. Now, how can any yoga teacher go in and give a class if they've got to come up with that kind of overhead? And he said, they're treating us as equals. They're treating us as equals, but it's really uncomfortable because they're afraid that we're going to expose what they're doing. So we did something called the clown board meeting, where we put little clown hats on them. And I think we offended some of our fellow producers because they thought Paula and Joe are being so disrespectful of the town. You know, how do they expect that, you know, we're going to get what we want? But we know what these people are really doing. They are getting ready to steal. So why not put them in clown hats and say, well, if you're not a clown, then you're a criminal. So, you know, so maybe people will laugh, but, you know, how serious are they about the problems? Are they looking at the problems? You have to kind of entertain them. And look at Groucho Marx. Look at a lot of these people that were comedians, but they were deep people. When you look at their private life, what they were up to, they knew about this game that people were stealing from them.
Interesting. I mean, it seems like it's also a reason. It's something that I'm always fighting, is if I, you know, really believe in some of these other dimensions or ways of viewing the world, there's always a voice in my head kind of laughing, or I'm aware of the people who laugh at all of that. That's a way of really keeping you stuck.
Right, but the thing is, they're only going to laugh because they think it doesn't work, and they really believe it's silly. They really believe. They're really laughing, you know. But if it is silly, then you're going to figure it out. You know what I mean? But don't think that you did wrong by believing. That's when you have your self-acceptance. You're going to, you know, wow, I'm really a beautiful person. I really believe we could have a world without war. You know, where you take the sword and make it into the plow. And it's just been said too many times by too many masters and too many religions that it just couldn't be nonsense. And then when you see the healings, that's not nonsense. And then you prove that the other remedy that everybody's not laughing at, because there's so much money involved, they're killing people. And then you rest your case. And then you don't gloat about it, because you're light years beyond their opinion. You know, because you're connecting to your divinity.
Nice. Thank you. Okay. How do you feel? Are you getting cold? Or?
Kinda, yeah.
Yeah, it's getting a little dark.
Yeah. So, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Let's go warm up somewhere.
Yeah.
This is perfect.
They were desecrating this thing on purpose. There's some animosity going on, but it just seems shameful to have it in such a bad state of disrepair. You know how see the nose there?
Yeah.
Did you know in the Mystery of the Sphinx, they talk about the Sphinx and it's got the nose cut off?
Oh.
Well, apparently some superstitious people, or Muslims or whatever, knocked the nose, or maybe it happened during Napoleon's time, they knocked the nose off because the feeling was you take the power out of the object when you do that.
Interesting.
And that if there was any original power in this, I don't know if any holy person blessed it or whatever, you can never repair it. So it's never going to achieve its, from the tantric point of view, from what I've heard. Mm. But again, faith is everything too. Then you build it up again. Like those people, you know, who got cured of cancer despite massive amounts of chemo. Wow, that's a lot of faith. and it probably gives hope to their doctors, who probably knew they were killing them. And they said, wow, they didn't die. Well, what time is it?
I don't know. Let me check.